I remember I got a lot of trouble when I went on to Fox one morning, because I get into a lot of trouble, as you know, a lot of the times, because I think out loud. And it has been, quite honestly, the secret of my success, but also the source of many of my troubles. I take you along for the ride on my thinking process. And I remember sitting in the chair one day on the cozy couch at Fox. And I was on Fox and Friends one morning, and I said something along the lines, I think the president is a racist. He has a hatred for the white culture. And I was thinking out loud. And oh, how stupid I was. I thought those were the days when I thought we could have adult conversations and we could try to find the truth together. Well, as it turns out, that was wrong. But kind of on the right track, kind of. The reason why I said that is I was trying to figure out there's something wrong. He seems to hate America. He seems to be outside of the culture. White, black, doesn't matter. The whole thing, he seems to be outside of it. And I couldn't figure it out. And one of the things, the first tip-off to me was this. This is the bust of Winston Churchill. This is an exact replica that we had made. And we actually had to call the chief historian of the White House and get them to send us photographs of it and measurements of it so we could recreate it for this Oval Office. This is what the Oval Office looked like when George W. Bush was in it. It is dramatically changed, but the main thing that has changed since Barack Obama was in it is that bust, which was a gift from the British, our closest ally and friend. This was a gift from the British as well, the Resolute Desk. That bust was taken out and boxed up and shipped back to England. It was a gift after the attacks of 9/11. And it was how it was done that bothered me and confused me. It was boxed up after the British Prime Minister said, no, Mr. President, that's a gift from the British people. And Barack Obama said, no, well, we don't need it. And he said, well, you put it in a museum. It was a gift from the British people. And what happened next was the Prime Minister left and Obama had it boxed up and shipped back. Well, we obviously couldn't get the original, so we had another one made and put it back where it belongs. But this is the key to the show tonight. This is where things for me, when they took it, when they took it off out of the Oval Office and they shipped it back to England, that's when things got confusing to me. But to me, that's where our journey begins. The only guy who I think gets it, and the key to him getting it, is he was born in another country. And we've had him on the show several times before. But this is the only man I think that truly understands Obama. Because he had something most Americans don't. In a way, an anti-colonialist upbringing. This guy meant something to Dinesh D'Souza as a kid. This guy played a role. Director, co-writer Dinesh D'Souza, an executive producer of a new film, John Sullivan are here. The new film is called 2016. I just watched it, as did every member of the audience just a few minutes ago. And it explains Barack Obama. Who here, A, has a fuller understanding of Barack Obama after watching the film? Right? How many people think that you have a friend that you can get to watch this film and it will change their mind? Really? Well, that gives me such hope. What is it that you think will change people's mind? What part? Becky?
I think it's because it comes from such an intellectual place and not like openly defiant, being very, you know, oh my God, I don't like Obama because X. It's very, again, it's very intellectual, it's very easy to understand. It follows such a simple formula of just asking questions.
Right.
As opposed to saying...
I tried asking questions before. That doesn't necessarily not hack people off. Lindsay, yes.
I think knowledge is power, and the more they know about them, the more they'll be empowered to make their own.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes, in the very back, yes.
I don't necessarily think it's going to change supporters' minds.
Yeah.
I do think it'll enlighten people that are that know something is not right, but can't put their finger on it, and mm-hmm. will reinforce for them when they're being told by the media that you know, keep on moving, folks. Nothing's going on here.
Okay. Yeah. So let me start with Dinesh. I didn't know this was the key, but I knew something was really, really wrong. Explain this.
Well, this man, Winston Churchill, is known to most Americans as the great fighter of the Nazis. We will fight them on the beaches. We will never surrender. And that's why Churchill is a bipartisan hero in America. But when I was growing up as a kid in Mumbai, in Bombay, we learned more about the other Churchill. And this was the Churchill who, from his young years, was a colonialist. He rode with the colonial armies in Afghanistan. He was with Lord Kitchener in the Sudan, a famous battle called Omdurman. Later, he became the colonial secretary in charge of all the colonies. Now, interestingly, with Churchill, when he met Gandhi, India's anti-colonial leader, Churchill said, "I will not be the prime minister to preside over the liquidation of the British Empire." And in the 1950s, when Obama's father was growing up, there was an anti-colonial uprising in Kenya. Obama's father was arrested, his grandfather was detained, and it was Winston Churchill who had been re-elected as Prime Minister of Britain. He sent in the British troops that crushed the anti-colonial uprising in Kenya. So Obama has good reason to hate this guy.
When you saw this go out of the Oval Office, most Americans, I still tell this story about this statue and that it has been shipped back. And most of how many people knew this story when you saw the film? I mean, that's amazing, because how many people watch, you know, generally watch my show a lot. Okay? So you watch my show a lot. I've talked about this story over and over again. Still, I run into a majority of Americans, they have no idea this happened. When it happened, I didn't know what it meant. How long, what did this say to you when you heard this story?
Well, the Churchill incident actually came to me after I had started thinking about the anti-colonialism of Barack Obama. The reason I got onto that topic was I started almost casually reading his autobiography, Dreams from My Father.
Keyword, from.
From my father, right? He's not talking about his father's dreams. These are the dreams that he, Obama, got from his dad.
Right.
And as I was thumbing through that book, I realized that this is not about Selma. It's not about the civil rights movement. Obama or his father didn't sit at segregated lunch counters. They're not descended from slaves. This is a third world story that moves from Hawaii to Indonesia to Kenya. And I realized, you know, Obama's talking about rickshaws, lepers, you know, kids crossing the road, the smells of funny types of food. And I'm like, wow. That's what I grew up. That's the familiar sounds and smells of the Bombay I was raised in. So as I began to think about Obama's ideology, when this incident came up, it became a sort of a test for me, a confirmation that I was on the right path. Because to me, the strength of a theory is this. Can it explain facts that no other theory can explain? So people will say, Obama's a Muslim, Obama's a socialist, Obama's this, Obama's that. But this theory, this fact, the Churchill bust, the anti-colonial theory explains, and all other theories fall short. So to me, it was an eye-opener.
Right. But it is the anti-colonialist. I mean, his father and his mother were Marxist as well.
Well, remember that anti-colonialism burst on the world in the 50s and 60s, and the Cold War was raging. And for all these newly independent countries, they wanted to be anti-Western, anti-British. America had been coming to the forefront. So how do you be anti-Western? Who was America's enemy? The Soviet Union. So it became natural for all these guys to say, we're against these guys. we embrace the Soviets, we embrace socialism, we go the other way. And so Nehru went that way, Sukarno in Indonesia, Nkrumah in Ghana. This was the world I grew up in. My father felt this way, my grandfather felt this way. So when I read Barack Obama felt this way, I'm like, that's the way the world was for a lot of these people.
I want to talk a little bit about what's happened to your life since you did this. Since we had you on Fox, you put this story out, and they killed you for it. We'll talk about that a little bit. Why the heck would you get involved in this? I mean, this guy is a pariah. This is crazy.
I know. I keep unsavory friends, I guess.
Yeah, I know.
No, it just seemed like a very interesting theory when I first read Dinesh's book. In fact, we were sitting at lunch one day, and we were talking about another project to do. I'd just done Expelled with Ben Stein, and we were talking about doing another project. And he said, hey, I'm going to write this book on Barack Obama. And I said, Dinesh, I would drop everything else, and I'd make that into a movie if you want to do that. And so that's kind of how this journey started. And even seeing all this, I think what pointed me in one direction was, look at, when you start hearing people clamoring this much, who else, what other writer has been attacked like Dinesh has?
Oh, yeah.
So suddenly, you know, where there's smoke, there's fire.
Mm-hmm.
Like Dinesh was saying, suddenly they started making little facts, suddenly kind of pieced together a much larger picture.
That was the amazing thing is, I mean, Dinesh, we've spoken several times, and you know, you used to see me on Fox, and you must have just went, oh, geez, Glenn, you're missing it. But that's the way I think we all feel. There's this that just doesn't make sense, and this that doesn't make sense, and this doesn't make sense, and this doesn't make sense. And so you keep trying to, Americans, keep trying to put it and jam it into the box, into things we understand. We understand communism. I thought it was dead, but it's not. You know, we start putting in that, and it's like, that doesn't really work. You start putting it in racist things. Well, that doesn't work. And so you don't have an answer. You don't have an answer.
Yeah, there are even conservatives who will say of Obama, you know, he's just a bungler. He's an amateur. He's an incompetent. He's never.
Never.
So their point is he keeps getting results opposite to what he intends.
That's insane.
And I just step back and say, maybe he's getting the results he does intend.
Right.
That's an easier way to understand a man. So I think the big error with Obama on the right and the left is we all think we're having this policy debate among people who share goals. We all want America to be prosperous. We all want America to be strong. We all want America to be number one. We're just debating how to get there. The message of this film is, wait a minute, there may be one guy, and he happens to be the guy, who is outside that consensus, and for good reason, has a very different agenda.
When we come back, I want to ask that question, because that's the number one question of George Soros, of what I say about Barack Obama, what I say about Van Jones, they'll say, why? I mean, Glenn, they're successful. They make money. They've got all this power, blah, blah, blah. Why would they want the America that we understand and know destroyed? Answer that question when we come back. Dinesh, why would Barack Obama want to destroy the United States?
Well, Barack Obama's not a sort of traitor, or he hates America, or anything like that. He subscribes to an ideology that sees America as the rogue nation in the world. What is this ideology? It's kind of a third world anti-Americanism, anti-colonialism. The basic idea here is that the whole ship of the world has gone wrong side up. And it's gone wrong side up for 500 years because one civilization, Europe, America, has conquered the rest of the world and stolen its stuff. That's the theory, that these rich countries only became rich by taking the wealth of the poor countries. So Obama, it has a global vision, and that is, I want to set the ship of the world right. And what that means is that America has to go down so the rest of the world can come up.
The night he was elected, he said something along the lines that, because of what we've done today, we have begun to change America and fix the world.
Remaking America. That was his phrase. And as I listened to that, I thought to myself, how do you remake America without unmaking America?
Right.
So
it's not rebuild. It was remade.
Right. You got to take down the America that there is to put something new in its place. So now, weirdly, I think from Obama's point of view, he's doing what's good for America. It's almost like he's the coach of the Lakers, and he thinks it's really bad for the Lakers to keep winning. Why? Because it's making them arrogant, it's making them greedy and selfish and exploitative. It would be really good for the Lakers to start losing. So he's calling plays for the Lakers to lose. Now, if we're the Lakers, we'd want to fire this guy, right? But first we have to know that that's his agenda. And the genius of Obama is that he can do exactly what he wants, but explain it in terms that throw us off his path.
You put in the film because, you know, you use the Lakers analogy here. No, I don't have to know that that's agenda. If I'm a Lakers fan and the guy keeps losing, do you have to know his agenda to want him fired? No, you don't have to. But people don't, generally, I mean, 40% approval rating is astounding with this kind of record.
He's defying gravity.
Right. You have in the movie this amazing fact that Obama figured it out while he was in college. That people would want to help him if he put a mask on, right?
Yep.
Obama possesses in his pocket what can be called certificates of racial absolution. Now, I don't mean by this simply the fact that he's black, he's African American. That's not the key to it. The key to it is that he's a different kind of African American. He's not Jesse Jackson, he's not Al Sharpton. We're used to black leaders who make racial demands. You're a racist. Unless you pay me. And that has put America in a very defensive position. Here comes Obama, and he never brings the subject up. He's above it. He's the racial healer. So the point to make
here...
No, he's not, but the fact that he doesn't intimidate you with explicit racial appeals is immensely relieving to whites, because whites go, oh, wow, he allows us to believe that we've gotten beyond all that by voting for him. See, I wondered to myself, why are all these guys like Chris Matthews? Chris Matthews is a hardcore guy. I mean, he grew up with Tip O'Neill. He's, you know, he's on the docks of Boston. He's a tough guy. But when he talks about Obama,
he's got a tingle.
He says, oh, I got a tingle down my leg. He begins to talk in a very effeminate way. Now, why? I think it's nothing to do with Obama. It's Chris Matthews able to say that by my supporting Obama, I'm patting myself on the back. I'm a morally wonderful human being because I can vote for this guy. So this is Obama's secret weapon. He disarms us, and he brings out from the left this sycophantic dedication that is unprecedented.
You have a point in the documentary about the caliphate, the United States of Islam. There was a few times I knew I was on the right track when I had you on, when I talked about the caliphate, when I said the Muslim Brotherhood was just absolutely evil and infiltrated the United States, when I talked about social justice being evil, and get out of your church if it's a social justice church. If be very careful of that term, find out exactly what that means. The gates of hell opened up on me, and the caliphate was the last one that just the gates of hell opened up. And look at what's happening now.
Yeah, I think Obama wants to reduce America's footprint in the world because he thinks we're stepping on the world. So what he's doing is encouraging anti-American forces in the Middle East. He used force to push out Gaddafi in Libya, and he used diplomacy to push out Mubarak in Egypt. Now, what did those two guys have in common? They were both doing business with the United States. Gaddafi is no friend of ours, but he was behaving himself since 2002. Mubarak was probably our greatest ally in the region, not counting Israel. Meanwhile, Obama refuses to use force when there's massive casualties
Iran?
In Syria.
Didn't even bring up Iran.
There were Iran, you had bigger demonstrations than Tahrir Square.
Yeah.
And Obama says, not only did he not intervene, he told the rest of us to be quiet, let's be calm. And all of that died off. So what does Syria and Iran have in common? They're deadly enemies of the United States, and they are allied with each other. So the only consistent explanation for Obama's double standard in using force over here, but not over there, pushing this guy out, keeping that guy in.
The name of the documentary is 2016, which implies you can see down the road to what it's going to be like in 2016. Stop at Israel. What does Israel look like in 2016?
If I were an anti-colonialist, I would say that it is not enough to have a Palestinian state. It's not enough to give the West Bank and Gaza back. Why? Because the anti-colonial view is that Israel itself is the little colonial power, the little American surrogate sitting and occupying Muslim land.
It's a cancer.
So if I was an anti-colonialist, I would think, what is a clever way to get rid of Israel, to return the whole of Israel to the Muslims? Now, I think I would know the Jews aren't going anywhere, but I would think of ways like, what if I were to support a right of return for Palestinian refugees? What if I were to make it so that Muslims would be the majority in Israel? Then the Jews would be a minority in their own country, and it would cease to be a Jewish country. And I could achieve that result by demanding democracy. Everyone has an equal vote. Just as if I wanted anti-colonialism in the Middle East, I would demand that Saudi Arabia have a free election. I'd say, royal family, we've seen it now in Egypt. You put yourself on the ballot. You run against the Muslim Brotherhood, and let's see who wins that election. So we look at the Middle East. There are three important countries. There's Iran, there's Egypt, there's Saudi Arabia. Iran has been in the hands of the radical Muslims since 79. Egypt is in the process of transporting itself into the hands of the Muslim Brotherhood. Who's left? Saudi Arabia. So if the radical Muslims get that one, they have Mecca, they have Medina.
If I'm not mistaken, over in the Middle East, 2011 was known as the year of the dictators, and 2012-13 is known as the year of the kings, meaning first we took care of the dictators, next come the kings, which would make you right. One more quick thing. You have a piece where you show Barack Obama sitting with what's his name in Russia, and he leans
Medvedev.
Yeah, Medvedev,
the Russian president.
And he leans over and he says, "Listen, I need some more room here. I'll have more room to maneuver." Chilling, bone chilling. Medvedev says, "I'll transmit to Vladimir."
And I stand with you.
Yeah, and I stand with you. What does that imply?
Well, that implies at the least that he has a hidden agenda. We may not know what that agenda is, but the clear meaning of what Obama is saying is he's saying, look, Medvedev, there are things I want to give you. And he's talking about missile defense in this case. He goes that if I were to tell the American people what those things are, they might not reelect me. So wait, give me space, give me flexibility, his actual words, so that I can do these things after I'm reelected. Remember, in the second term, a president is not tethered to public opinion. He becomes his own man. So weirdly, I think despite all we've seen about Obama, we haven't seen the full Obama.
That's frightening. Do we survive 2016 if he's elected?
Well, I think that we do not survive as, I mean, the risk is, will America still be a world superpower? That's question number one. The second is, what about America's wealth? Now, I mentioned in the film, this is directly from the Federal Reserve, American wealth from 2007 to now is down 40%. So that's almost half. If American wealth were to drop another 40% in the next 4 years, that would be a total decline of American wealth of 66%, not 80%, but 66%. America would cease to be a first world country, because this is happening at the time when other countries are dramatically coming up. Brazil, Indonesia, Chile, India. So America would essentially drop back into the also-ran of nations, which is to say we would be exactly in the position that the world was in 1500, before colonialism. There was no superpower. There were multiple nodes of influence.
That's
the world I believe that Obama wants.
Okay, back with questions from the audience in a minute. Let's start with Colt.
Yeah, my question is, I know Obama went out of his way to kind of silence Jeremiah Wright for not talking too much. I was curious to know how receptive people were when you were trying to gather information on him now that he's already president.
Well, the remarkable thing about Obama is that, in a sense, we felt in covering him that we had the field almost to ourselves. When I saw George Obama...
How sad is that?
How sad is that? I'm in Kenya, I'm talking to people who knew his dad, who knew his mom. I'm interviewing his half-brother, George. We're sitting at the Obama homestead. Here's the family house. There's the graveyards. We're sipping Coca-Colas. It's almost like the uncovered story of the world, so to speak. With Jeremiah Wright, here you have the deafness of Obama, because the core issue of Jeremiah Wright was not the race issue. It was goddamn America. The key to his argument was that we are the rogue nation in the world, right? He says, we took this country away from the Indians. We bombed Hiroshima. We bombed Nagasaki. So we're the bad guy. Not Iran, North Korea. We're the bad guy. That's the issue. What does Obama do? Obama realizes this is bad. If this comes out, it sort of outs me politically. So off he goes to Philadelphia, and he gives a race speech. He goes, oh, we Americans, you know, there are some racial problems we've never come to terms with. And everyone's watching and go, oh, that's right. We've never come to terms with, you know. So beautifully, he's changed the topic and brought it onto strong ground. And the real issue gets camouflaged, gets pushed to the side. So that's the one time that his candidacy was in real peril, and he got his way out of it.
I can't see your name. Ken. Hi, Ken.
Got a question. The movie really scared me. At 1.5 minutes from the end, when you showed us going down to zero atomic bombs compared to 15 in Russia, will our military people allow him to take it to that point? Can they stop him?
No. He's the commander-in-chief. They work for him. He doesn't work for them.
He's also changed fundamentally the inside of the Pentagon.
He sets policy. Remember, the beauty of Obama is that he'll never say, he's not going to say, I'm trying to disarm the United States. He'll say, I dream of a world free of nuclear weapons. And, of course, he's only slashing our weapons while the Chinese, the Indians, the Pakistanis, everybody else is building, modernizing. Mm-hmm. Similarly, if Obama's canceling oil drilling contracts, he'll never say, I want America to have less oil, I want America. He goes, you know, he gives the impression, I'm an environmentalist. So at every stage, he's able to state a theory. And that's why people follow him, right? People think, oh, yeah, that's right. And conservatives go, oh, he's mistaken about his environmentalism. He doesn't realize the global warming. Obama doesn't care if the earth is getting hotter or colder. That means nothing to him. What he's trying to do is redistribute energy globally. And therefore, he's articulated policies that says we limit our energy use. And he's also said we've got to give money to the third world so they can grow and use energy in a responsible
way. That's why, at the same time we cut our oil, we started funding oil exploration deeper sea exploration with Brazil. Zach.
Well, I have a question. I really enjoyed the film, but notice you focused on everyone in his life except for his mother, who is probably around him more than anyone else. And coming from, you know, in my family, I grew up in a similar situation where, you know, my mom's impression of my dad was really what I had growing up. And I think that her impression of his father seemed to really be transmitted into his mind. And it showed through when you spoke of his stepfather and how she put him down. And really, she was still standing up for those same principles. So I just wondered if you had gone down that path and found something, or if that just hadn't been.
No, in fact, when I was on Glenn's show, a couple of years ago, I had focused on the father and sort of neglected the mother, because Obama, in Dreams from My Father, describes his mom as kind of this woman who would stare at the moon and was kind of an idealist. And I thought she was probably not that important. But I realized subsequently, as being in Indonesia, talking to people who knew the mom, she actually was as ferocious in her commitments as Barack Sr. They were of one mind. That's what they had in common. Mm-hmm. And even when he dumped her, she got rid of him, but she didn't get rid of his ideals.
Did she know she was a polygamist too?
Well, she was a 60s girl and a bohemian.
So it was okay. Yeah.
And, you know, for a long time I thought Barack Obama Sr. is the playboy. But, of course, he wasn't a playboy. He was a traditional luo guy marrying multiple wives. She was the playgirl in that when she was in Indonesia, one of her motives for sending young Barack home, well, part of it was let's get him away from this pro-American stepfather. But the other influence was let me be a swinger in Indonesia. She lived the rest of her life in Indonesia. And I think that's why Obama didn't go when she was dying of cancer.
This is another influence on his life. This is a book that my company has just published. And it will actually be featured when it comes out here in a couple of weeks on Sean Hannity's program. It's bought by Paul Kangor, and you spoke to him at length on this. Frank Marshall Davis is a spooky, spooky, dangerous communist and played a huge role in Barack Obama's life. Franny, one more question before we go to break.
Just wait till the mask comes off. And so I was wondering, what does that look like? I mean, I'm imagining, you know, he's very calm and composed when he speaks now and all, but what does it look like in the next term? What is the mask?
You know, I've often explained him as you know, the Mission Impossible guy, that he's wearing this mask, and I'm not sure that there is somebody real behind that, I don't know if he knows who he is.
Yes, I do think that he was a fractured soul growing up.
Right.
I mean, he was abandoned not just by his father, but he, even on the campaign, he was raised by a single mother. But no, from the age of 10, he had neither father nor mother.
Yeah.
That's not easy. So the way Frank Marshall Davis came into it is the grandfather, who's a bit of a goofball, says, oh, well, there's this black guy who's living in a shack down by the water, Waikiki Beach. Let's take Obama down there so he has a black role model. So here's, you know, here's Stanley Dunham, the grandfather. Here's Frank Marshall Davis. Apologies for pointing at you. But the two of them would smoke dope. They would play Scrabble. And here's little Obama sitting in the corner listening to Frank Marshall Davis's anti-American diet tribes week after week, and this went on, remember, for 7 years.
Right.
So this is a guy who had a major influence on Obama's life. So at the end of the day, what's left of Obama? I'm not sure in personality what's left. I do see some very interesting traces of his father. I mean, one of the things that we find out about his father in the film, his father was a kind of a fabulist, and by that I mean is he was a great spinner of tales. He would go to meetings and he would say, oh, you know, I'm the minister from Kenya. And they'd say, oh, you're the trade minister? Well, come over here and so on. He'd be the VIP. Pretty soon the real trade minister would show up and they would think that guy's an imposter. This guy would be posing as the minister from Kenya. Now, when I first saw that, I thought, what's he doing? There's a tendency here, because when someone is magnetic, to spin tales. And if you spin them enough, people will believe you. The thing about Obama is he lives in his own world, and I think he feels he can stand up with Bill Clinton and say, us two guys are the greatest cutters of spending in recent American history. This is like a flat-out falsehood, but Obama says it with such passion, such conviction, he bites his lip, and so on, that at a certain point you think, well, he can't be making that up.
Right.
But no, that's the fabulism.
That's why he is so effective, because most people just can't believe that somebody would look into the camera and say, I'm not really here. I'm invisible right now. I mean, you just can't believe that somebody could pull that off with a straight face and have the guts and the, quite honestly, the evil tendency to lie to the American people like that. We just as Americans can't accept that. The name of the movie is 2016. It is, I believe, let me quote a governor. In fact, the governor of Texas called me up 2 weeks ago, saw it with you, and he called me up, and he's always giving me, you know, videos and stuff. You got to watch this. I'm like, all right, governor, whatever. And I mean, I say, absolutely. He called me right before I went on the air, and he said, Glenn, you take all the stuff that I've ever given you, just throw it out the door. There's one movie that every American should see. I just saw it myself. I concur. 2016. See it. Bring a friend. Not somebody who's been hypnotized, but somebody who you think is reasonable. Bring them to 2016. Back in a minute. Movie opens today, right? In select cities?
It opens in Houston and then goes nationwide.
For more information, just follow the links at the bottom of the screen.